Freemasonry is a secret fraternal order that has existed for hundreds, arguably thousands of years, and is now operating in most every country in the world. Masonry promotes itself as a philanthropic club for men of morals, and they perpetuate this image through members of the first three blue degrees. 97% of all Masons fall into this category, and they are often upstanding citizens, pillars of the community who truly are charitable and benevolent. However, the higher degrees, the inner circle of World Freemasonry, use the society's worldwide influence to advance their control. Acharya S. wrote, "Although the Brotherhood of Masonry appears to be relatively new, it is in reality the oldest continuous network on the planet, dating back many thousands of years, beginning when stones were first dressed. Masonry today has a generally sinister reputation because the people suspect that this powerful brotherhood has been manipulating and exploiting them. However, the average Mason has never been in the know and is therefore merely a member of a social club. Nevertheless, the higher-ups have indeed had their hand in creation on this planet on a large scale for a long time. The Masons are there, perpetually hidden behind the scenes, leaving clues to their existence as a brotherhood, some of which are evident, yet still not seen. For example, the biblical Nimrod, the king who built the Tower of Babel, is considered the first Mason." Jim Mars wrote, "The ongoing connective tissue between the modern and ancient secret societies has been Freemasonry, which existed as a formidable force long before certain lodges became Illuminized. During the late Middle Ages, when any opposition to the Holy Roman Universal Catholic Church was forced deep underground, among the only organized groups able to move freely throughout Europe were the guilds of stonemasons, who maintained meeting halls, or lodges, in every major city. The Masons, who traced their own secret knowledge of architecture and building back to Egypt and beyond, were essential in the construction of Europe's churches and cathedrals. They were the direct descendants of early guilds of Masons, which existed both in Egypt and Greece, and utilized esoteric construction techniques in their craft. These techniques had been passed down through the sects and mystery schools, and some continue to confound modern builders. Freemasonry evolved over the last 1,000 years from the Knights Templar, and before that traces its roots to ancient Egypt, the Egyptian mystery religion and esoteric schools. Some believe the original Masons were the builders of the pyramids, or that they hold the secrets of those early Master Masons. Freemasonry is not, however, merely a builders and stoneworkers guild. Right from the first degree, initiates take blood oaths, perform occult rituals, and begin learning about a number of arcane subjects, delving deeper as they rise in degrees. Some of the subjects studied and practiced include astrology, consciousness, magic, tarot, Kabbalah, the Tree of Life, sacred geometry, divination, scrying, theosophy, numerology, symbology, alchemy, hermeticism, the chakra system, auras, energy bodies, astral projection, out-of-body experiences, kundalini, geomancy, Masonic occult history, and philosophy, metaphysics, epistemology, secret handshakes, and secret gestures. Masons rise in degrees through a process of rituals and initiations. They read books like Machiavelli's The Prince and Albert Pike's Morals and Dogma, then write essays detailing whether they agree philosophically with people like Pike, Hegel, Machiavelli, and others. These essays are then sent to the headquarters of International Freemasonry and reviewed by top-level Masons. If the initiate agrees that the few should control the many and that secret society rule is virtuous, etc., then he is congratulated and promoted through higher degrees. If the initiate disagrees that the few should control the many and holds a genuinely moral position, then he is congratulated and promoted within his existing branch, never to rise above the blue degrees. Every Mason will disagree with this, however, because most Blue Lodge Masons genuinely do not know, and high-ranking Masons are sworn to secrecy. Commander of the Supreme Council of the 33rd Degree and Supreme Pontiff of Universal Freemasonry, Albert Pike, wrote in his Morals and Dogma, "The blue degrees are but the outer court or portico of the temple. Parts of the symbols are displayed there to the initiate, but he is intentionally misled by false interpretations. It is not intended that he shall understand them, but it is intended that he shall imagine that he understands them. Their true implication is reserved for the adepts, the princes of Masonry. 33rd degree Masonic historian Manly P. Hall wrote, "Freemasonry is a fraternity within a fraternity, an outer organization concealing an inner brotherhood of the elect. It is necessary to establish the existence of these two separate yet interdependent orders, the one visible and the other invisible. The visible society is a splendid camaraderie of free and accepted men enjoined to devote themselves to ethical, educational, fraternal, patriotic, and humanitarian concerns. The invisible society is a secret and most august fraternity whose members are dedicated to the service of a mysterious arcanum arcandrum, a sacred secret. Those brethren who have essayed to write the history of their craft have not included in their disquisitions, a formal discourse or treatise, the story of that truly secret inner society, which is to the body Freemasonic what the heart is to the body human. In each generation, only a few are accepted into the inner sanctuary of the work. The great initiate philosophers of Freemasonry are masters of that secret doctrine, which forms the invisible foundation of every great theological and rational institution." The process from a first to 33rd degree Freemason may take 10, 20, 30, or more years, but is not based on time. The way initiates rise degrees is through invitation by members of a higher degree. This is the nature of all secret societies. The only way to get ahead is by appeasing those ahead of you. It is through this bootlicking pyramid structure that the few bloodline elite at the top control the many at the bottom. Then, by issuing lords, knights, and vassals of various degrees along the way to do their bidding, the royals essentially control all facets of this worldwide brotherhood. Manly P. Hall wrote, "The initiated brother realizes that his so-called symbols and rituals are merely blinds fabricated by the wise to perpetuate ideas incomprehensible to the average individual. He also realizes that few Masons of today know or appreciate the mystic meaning concealed within these rituals." Jim Mars wrote, "The invitation-only 33rd degree is the highest publicly known degree. The vast majority of members look upon their affiliation with Freemasonry as little different from joining the Lions Club, the Optimists, or the Chamber of Commerce. And from their standpoint, this is true. Even Masonic literature makes clear that only those initiates who progress beyond 33rd degree status are educated in the group's true goals and secrets. This hierarchy is readily admitted by Masonic authors. There has always existed an external, elementary, popular doctrine which has served for the institution of the masses who are insufficiently prepared for deeper teaching," wrote Mason Wilmshurst. "There has been an interior, advanced doctrine, a more secret knowledge, which has been reserved for riper minds and into which only proficient and properly prepared candidates who voluntarily sought to participate in it were initiated. The highest known formal degree of Masonry is the 33rd degree. This title has been held by many world leaders and important names in modern history. The following U.S. presidents were known to be Masons, many of them 33rd degree: Washington, Jefferson, Madison, Monroe, Jackson, Polk, Buchanan, Johnson, Garfield, McKinley, Roosevelt, Taft, Harding, Roosevelt, Truman, Ford, Carter, Reagan, Clinton, both Bushes, and Obama. All the following people were also Masons, most of them 33rd degree: Buzz Aldrin, John Glenn, Yasser Arafat, Tony Blair, John Wilkes Booth, James Cameron, Winston Churchill, Walt Disney, Bob Dole, Frederick Engel, Newt Gingrich, Mikhail Gorbachev, Al Gore, Billy Graham, Richard Holbrooke, J. Edgar Hoover, Colonel Mandel House, Saddam Hussein, Burl Ives, Jesse James, Jesse Jackson, Henry Kissinger, Vladimir Lenin, Robert McNamara, Karl Marx, Lord Alfred Milner, Benjamin Netanyahu, Albert Pike, Prince Philip, Colin Powell, Cecil Rhodes, James Rothschild, Charles Taze Russell, Joseph Stalin, Strom Thurmond, Leon Trotsky, Paul Warburg, H.G. Wells, and thousands more. Tex Mars wrote, "When we examine the historical record of the world's most despicable mass murderers and revolutionaries, we find that almost all of them were members of Freemasonry and other secret societies of the Illuminati. Robespierre was a Freemason, Weishaupt was a Freemason, Napoleon was a Freemason, Lenin was a Freemason, Stalin was a Freemason, Truman and Roosevelt were Freemasons, Ariel Sharon is a Freemason, Bill Clinton is a Freemason, Fidel Castro is a Freemason." Traditional history insists that the Revolutionary War was fought over the British monarchy's unjust taxation of America. While this is true on one level, it is also true that the leaders of the American Revolution, the signers of the Constitution and Declaration of Independence, were all descendants of British aristocratic bloodlines, and most of them Freemasons. Manly P. Hall wrote, "Not only were many of the founders of the United States government Masons, but they received aid from a secret and august body existing in Europe, which helped them to establish this country for a peculiar and particular purpose known only to the initiated few." David Ovison wrote, "The very struggle for independence seems to have been directed by the Masonic Brotherhood, and some historians insist had even been started by them." Graham Hancock wrote, "Freemasonry was the driving force behind the ideals and tenets of the American Revolution. What is less well known is the fact that there was a very close connection between the French and American Masonic lodges at that time. In those days, Freemasonry in America was regulated by United Grand Lodge in England, which appointed provincial Grand Masters in various regions of the North American continent. Before the Revolutionary War, the New World of the Americas lacked unity and autonomous identity. For almost 300 years, there was no military, constitution, or federal government. Then, within 2 short years, the snap of a historical finger, America had Continental Marines, Continental Congress, and the Articles of the Confederation. With the Declaration of Independence, the British colonialists, or Americans, officially separated from the British nationalists. Freemason and bloodline general George Washington became first president of the now United States of America, and royal rule of America switched from overt to covert. Royal and secret society rule had not changed, only the perception of governance changed, while the same DNA stayed in office. Instead of peasants well aware of their plight, knowing the monarchs and emperors oppressing them, we became peasants who actually believed we were born into a free and open system." Jim Mars wrote, "Freemasonry, the oldest and most powerful secret society in the history of the world, had planted firm roots in early day America and even played a significant role in the American Revolution. It played an even greater role in the subsequent French Revolution, which initially was greeted with great joy and approval in the United States. The number of Masonic lodges grew and membership increased. By 1826, it was estimated that Masons in the United States numbered nearly 50,000, mostly educated and professional men. But in that year, one Mason broke ranks. It became known that a Captain William Morgan of Batavia, New York, was planning to publish a book revealing the secret symbols, handshakes, oaths, and purposes of the Freemasons. Morgan, a 30-year member of the order, wrote, "The bane of our civil institutions is to be found in Masonry, already powerful and daily becoming more so. I owe my country an exposure of its dangers." Before the book could be printed, Morgan and his publisher were kidnapped in Batavia. Irate friends and neighbors pursued the kidnappers and managed to rescue the publisher, but Morgan was not so fortunate. He was never seen again. Years later, a Mason named Henry L. Valance confided to his doctor as he lay dying that he and 2 other Masons had dropped Morgan into the Niagara River. Valance said since that night he had suffered from a guilty conscience, the mark of Cain, and sought absolution for his sin. If you listen to Hollywood's Masonic adventure movie, National Treasure, then six of the founding fathers were Freemasons. If you read various Masonic websites, they tend to admit 9 to 13 were Masons. But the truth is that the majority of the founding fathers were high-ranking Masons. David Icke wrote, "Of the 56 signatories of the American Declaration of Independence, at least 50 were known to be Freemasons, and only one known not to be." Ralph Epperson wrote, "The Supreme Council of the 33rd degree of the Scottish Rite of Freemasonry has told the student that 13 of 39 original signers of the Constitution were Masons." It is also interesting to note that there were 39 signers, exactly three times the Masonic number 13. 13 is an important number to the Masons. There are 13 degrees in York Rite Freemasonry, and there just happened to be 13 original colonies, including New York. New York is known as the Empire State, with the Empire State Building. But whose empire? Who's the emperor? Perhaps the York Rite Freemasons could tell us. 13 Masons signed the Constitution, along with 26, 13 times 2, non-Masons, making the 39, 13 times 3. There also just happens to be 39 members of the Rockefeller's Bilderberg Inner Circle, and 39 floors in Rockefeller's United Nations building. The majority of the U.S. Founding Fathers, the Senate, and the Presidents have been Freemasons, but those who were not usually had nothing good to say about the organization. President John Quincy Adams wrote, "I do consciously and sincerely believe that the Order of Freemasonry, if not the greatest, is one of the greatest moral and political evils under which the Union is now laboring. A conspiracy of the few against the equal rights of the many. Masonry ought forever to be abolished. It is wrong, essentially wrong, a seed of evil, which can never produce any good." President Millard Fillmore wrote, "The Masonic fraternity tramples upon our rights, defeats the administration of justice, and bids defiance to every government which it cannot control." President Ulysses S. Grant said, "All secret oath-bound political parties are dangerous to any nation, no matter how pure or how patriotic the motives and principles which first bring them together." Supreme Court Chief Justice John Marshall said, "The institution of Masonry ought to be abandoned as one capable of much evil and incapable of producing any good which might not be effected by safe and open means." And Reverend John G. Stevens wrote, "Masonry was a state within a state, and that one day Masons would overthrow the democratic government of the United States and would crown one of their grand kings as ruler of this nation."